The Horse Stealer and Other Stories by Anton Chekhov. Narrated by Belinda Hillman. An Avenger. Shortly after finding his wife in flagrante delicto, Fyodor Fyodorovich Segev was standing in Schmuck and Company's, the gunsmith's, selecting a suitable revolver. His countenance expressed wrath, grief, and unalterable determination. "I know what I must do," he was thinking. "The sanctities of the home are outraged, honor is trampled in the mud, vice is triumphant, and therefore, as a citizen and a man of honor, I must be their avenger. First, I will kill her and her lover, and then myself." He had not yet chosen a revolver or killed anyone, but already in imagination he saw three blood-stained corpses, broken skulls, brains oozing from them, the commotion, the crowd of gaping spectators, the post-mortem. With the malignant joy of an insulted man, he pictured the horror of the relations in the public, the agony of the traitress, and was mentally reading leading articles on the destruction of the traditions of the home. The shopman, a sprightly little Frenchified figure with rounded belly and white waistcoat, displayed the revolvers and, smiling respectfully and scraping with his little feet, observed, "I would advise you, monsieur, to take this superb revolver, the Smith & Wesson pattern, the last word in the science of firearms, triple action with ejector, kills at 600 paces central sight. Let me draw your attention, monsieur, to the beauty of the finish, the most fashionable system, monsieur. We sell a dozen every day for burglars, wolves, and lovers. Very correct and powerful action, hits at a great distance and kills wife and lover with one bullet. As for suicide, monsieur, I don't know a better pattern." The shopman pulled and cocked the trigger, breathed on the barrel, took aim, and affected to be breathless with delight. Looking at his ecstatic countenance, one might have supposed that he would readily have put the bullet through his brains if he had only possessed a revolver of such a superb pattern as a Smith & Wesson. "And what price?" asked Segev.
45 rubles, monsieur."
That's too dear for me." "In that case, monsieur, let me offer you another make, somewhat cheaper. Here, if you'll kindly look, we have an immense choice at all prices. Here, for instance, this revolver of the Foucher pattern costs only 18 rubles, but—" The shopman pursed up his face contemptuously. "But, monsieur, it's an old-fashioned make. They are only bought by hysterical ladies or the mentally deficient. To commit suicide or shoot one's wife with a Lefauger revolver is considered bad form nowadays. Smith & Wesson is the only pattern that's correct style." "I don't want to shoot myself or to kill anyone," said Segev, lying sullenly. "I am buying it simply for a country cottage, to frighten away burglars." "That's not our business what object you have in buying it." The shopman smiled, dropping his eyes discreetly. "If we were to investigate the object in each case, monsieur, we should have to close our shop. To frighten burglars, Lefauger is not a suitable pattern, monsieur, for it goes off with a faint, muffled sound. I would suggest Mortimer's, the so-called dueling pistol." "Shouldn't I challenge him to a duel?" flashed through Segev's mind. "It's doing him too much honor. Though, beasts like that are killed like dogs." The shopman, swaying gracefully and tripping to and fro on his little feet, still smiling and chattering, displayed before him a heap of revolvers. The most inviting and impressive of all was the Smith & Wesson's. Segev picked up a pistol of that pattern, gazed blankly at it, and sank into brooding. His imagination pictured how he would blow out their brains, how blood would flow in streams over the rug and the parquet, how the traitress's legs would twitch in her last agony. But that was not enough for his indignant soul. The picture of blood, wailing, and horror did not satisfy him. He must think of something more terrible. "I know. I'll kill myself and him," he thought, "but I'll leave her alive, let her pine away from the stings of conscience and the contempt of all surrounding her. For a sensitive nature like hers, that will be far more agonizing than death." And he imagined his own funeral. He, the injured husband, lies in his coffin with a gentle smile on his lips, and she, pale, tortured by remorse, follows the coffin like a niobe, not knowing...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.